The programming problem is the most important part of the software engineer interview process. It's intended to provide a maximum of information in a minimum amount of time. But how do you go about designing a problem to ask in such an interview? And how will understanding the problem design process help you as a candidate for these interviews? Hi, I'm John Miller, the deliberate engineer. I spent the last 30 years working at companies like Microsoft, Google, and Amazon, both performing interviews and being interviewed by people. Over that time, I designed dozens of different programming problems and I was asked many more. Designing a programming problem is one of the most critical parts of being an interviewer. What lots of people don't realize, though, is that understanding how they're designed and the limitations of the programming problem can be extremely helpful to people who are being interviewed. So if you're sitting on either side of the table, during a software coding interview, it's very useful to understand the problem design process. The first thing to remember about the coding interview is that time is extremely limited. In the best of circumstances, you have a little less than an hour for the interview. In the worst of cases, you might only have a few minutes. How in the world can a programming interview reveal anything about the candidate in such a short amount of time? The answer is by design. An ideal coding question should take less than a minute to effectively communicate it to the candidate. It should also have an answer in a form that is easily verifiable and understood by both the candidate and the interviewer. The problem shouldn't rely on any sort of trick to be able to solve it. Instead, it should be able to be worked with common, well-known computer science techniques. A typical solution to a programming problem shouldn't require more than 10 or 20 lines to write out. Many times the candidate is sitting at a whiteboard writing out their answer by longhand. You don't want it to become an exercise in measuring how quickly somebody can write things down rather than how effectively they can code. Ideally, the problem will have several different solutions of varying efficiency. This lets the interviewer see whether the candidate is familiar with common forms of optimization for typical programming problems. It also lets the interviewer see how the candidate is at iterative problem solving. That is, how good they are at taking an existing solution and coming up with a better way of doing it. A good programming problem lets the interviewer judge progress incrementally rather than having to wait for the whole solution to be coded up. Also, an ideal coding problem has several different solutions with varying levels of efficiency. This lets the interviewer evaluate whether the candidate is familiar with common ways of optimizing solutions. It also allows the interviewer to see whether the candidate is able to provide incrementally better results. In other words, if they're able to improve a solution based upon an existing solution. One piece of advice I give candidates in every interview is to think out loud as they solve a problem. If you think that the problem is too difficult or there's no way you're going to be able to solve it quickly, then say that as you're thinking out loud. It may be that the interviewer actually wants to hear you push back against the definition of the problem. Maybe you're approaching it wrong, you need to work at it differently. Maybe there's some simplifying assumptions you can make. Maybe they're just looking for a pseudocode implementation to show that you understand the design. They're not actually looking for the individual code. Or maybe they will give you some complex piece of the solution as a utility function you can call rather than having to implement it yourself. You won't know the answer to any of these questions. You won't know whether they're possibilities unless you bring it up with the interviewer. If you're a candidate being asked programming questions, understanding the parameters that go into designing a good programming question can be extremely helpful. For example, it can reduce the solution space that you're working in to a much more tractable size. Let's say that you're programming and the only solution you can think of for the problem is 500 lines. In this case, you can be pretty certain this isn't what the interviewer intended. Either you're solving the wrong problem or your solution is so poor that it's something you wouldn't want to give anyways. As an interviewer asking a programming problem, you should know that problem very well. There should be several different solutions to the problem, and you should have coded each of them a couple times yourself to make sure that they can be coded in the amount of space and the amount of time that's going to be available during an interview. If you haven't written up code to solve a problem you're asking, if you haven't verified that it can be done in, say, 5 minutes by somebody who understands the problem, then you shouldn't be asking this problem in an interview. To help illustrate these concepts, I'd like to talk about my very favorite interview problem, one that I've been asking in one form or another for the last 25 years. This interview question originally started out as a problem that I had to solve while I was working on a game server called a Daiku Mud. Now, in this case, what happened was you would have a bunch of people using the server and playing the game at the same time. Periodically, all the connections would be evaluated and the current command that everybody had been input would be executed. The execution always took place in a certain order. It would work from the newest connections to the oldest connections. So somebody who understood this would make sure that they dropped connection and reconnected to the mud before they tried to do any sort of PvP, attacking another player on the server. If they did that, then they could dominate and control the fight. Now, my solution was a clever way of randomizing the order each time it was executed so that this exploit didn't work anymore. And so I thought it would make a great programming problem. The problem went something like this. Given a pointer to a function, and a pointer to an array of structures that each one represents a connection, call the function once in random order for each of the different connections that are ready to process in the input array. Now, it's a terrible description, absolutely terrible, and there's a lot of things wrong with this problem. First, it requires the user to understand things about the game. If they don't understand how network games work, there's going to have to be a conversation explaining to the candidate exactly what goes on, what do I mean by a connection, and how do they find out if the connection has any input or not, what happens if the connection was dropped, all kinds of things that wouldn't actually help me evaluate somebody as a candidate. The second problem is that it uses some relatively advanced C techniques, executing pointers to functions for functions that have arguments, telling the difference between a double pointer to an object, for example, a pointer to an array of pointers, or is it an array of structures, or what exactly does the object look like? Again, something that could be very distracting from the actual problem that I wanted to solve. It took me several times of asking this problem before I realized I needed to do something to improve it, and so I did. And this is a hallmark of many good programming problems. They may not be the best problem in the world when they start, but over time you iterate, make them easier to communicate, and make them more reasonable to solve. The final version of this problem wound up being, write a function PrintRandomSequence that prints the numbers from 1 to n in random order, each number exactly once. It's still a bit of a mouthful, but it's a much clearer problem and it's much easier to explain and give a couple simple examples. It's also much easier to verify that it's doing the right thing at the end. Over the course of asking this question for a couple months, I came to realize that it was a card shuffling problem. That wasn't my insight. One of the people I interviewed actually recognized it as this, and I quickly realized they were right. That's exactly what it was. Also, I got exposed to a couple solutions I hadn't thought of about the problem before. So I learned that there were three basic categories of problems, and that understanding it was a card shuffling problem made it much easier for the candidate to solve. Another nice thing about these three different solutions that people had was they varied quite a bit in terms of how efficient they are. The worst, but still okay solution is something that was actually non-terminating in a technical case, if there was a problem with the random number generator, for example. The best solution was order n, so it was really a great answer to the problem. It was one I didn't have at the very beginning. I found this problem to be useful in evaluating candidates anywhere from a fresh college hire to somebody with 10 or 15 years of experience. Because I'd asked it so many times, I had a good feeling for how long each of these sort of different categories of people should be able to solve the problem and how efficient their solution should be. In other words, the problem was calibrated. And this is a very useful feature for a programming problem. Make sure that it's calibrated so that you can get additional information from the same interview that you're doing with somebody. Each time you interview a new person and you see whether they succeed or fail in the interview loop, you sort of add that into the knowledge base that you have about the problem, and it helps you judge whether they're higher or no higher the next time you interview somebody with it. Now, as an interviewer, I recommend each interviewer come up with about a half dozen good questions that they can ask people. As you're designing these questions, you should work through the process I mentioned earlier, which is you write up the problem, you make sure you can communicate it well, you solve it a few times. Then, ideally, you go to your friends or your colleagues and you ask them the problem, make sure they understand it, and see how they do in solving it. As long as they perform well enough in solving the problem, you've probably got a good question on your hands that you can ask people in interviews. One of the reasons you want to have multiple questions is sometimes people will have already seen a question that you're asking. Sometimes it will have been asked earlier in the day. In that case, you can find out just by asking, have you seen this problem recently? Have you coded the solution to this problem recently? If they say yes, fine, you go on to another one. It's also good to have these problems fit into different categories. For example, I might have one problem that has to do with manipulating complex data structures, another one that has to do really more with solving the problem, like with the print random sequence problem. And I also had a bitwise question that I would ask people who claim to have a fair amount of experience with doing bitwise operations, you know, anding, oring, exclusive oring, things like this. The bitwise question I often asked was, implement the Boolean function is divisible by 8 that takes an integer as an argument. If the number is evenly divisible by 8, then you return true. Otherwise, you return false. And I give a few examples of it. Now, if somebody, a typical thing that somebody will do to solve this is to solve it with the modulo operator. But this isn't necessarily the most performant way to solve it, depending upon the type of CPU that you're running on. So after they solve it that way, I'll ask, well, is there a faster way to solve it? Somebody who's familiar with bitwise operations will usually find one. You don't have to have any special knowledge for this. You just need to understand the bitwise operators. Then typically I'll have a follow-up question, which is, okay, does it work for negative numbers? This part is a little harder, and it shows me whether the person understands 2's complement notation, which is typically used for representing positive and negative numbers in signed integers in a computer. If they understand it, then they can usually work through some logic that shows me, again, how fluent they are in the bitwise operators. Based on this, I can figure out whether they've really done anything with bitwise operators, or whether maybe they're exaggerating a little bit about some of their experience. So it's an interview problem that not only asks the question and sees if they can do problem solving, but it also helps expose information about what they have and haven't done in the past. By being a very simple problem, using very basic operators, if they've worked at all in bitwise areas, they should be able to make some progress on this. Another goal for programming problems that you ask in an interview is for them to be interesting to test, for them to show something about the thoroughness of the candidate. For example, my print random sequence problem, it's relatively straightforward to solve, but testing it can be quite difficult. So I'll ask people, well, is it correct? I might ask them, does it work well? Is it efficient? You know, how big a number can it work with? And there's some interesting branch conversations you can have there. For example, when the number of integers that you're trying to print is larger than the range of the random number generator. The most interesting test question to ask in this case is whether the results are really random. Now, if somebody takes a look and says, oh yeah, it's fine, that tells you they haven't really thought about randomness, and then you can have a conversation about what it means to be random and ask them what their definition of random is and how many different iterations they'll have to test and how big a numbers they can use. I've had conversations, interesting, deep technical conversations with candidates that have lasted half an hour just on this and told me a lot about the way they look at problems and whether they're able to think about the problem itself or only about the way they happen to solve it. So having a problem be interesting to test is very valuable for a good interview question. Summing things up, a good coding programming problem for interviews should be easy to communicate. It should take less than a minute to effectively have the candidate understand exactly what needs to be solved. It should have several different solutions so that the candidate has different options for how they go about solving the problem, and so that you can take them through iterative problem solving, improving their solution as you go along, both as the design consideration and in actually implementing and changing their implementation of the code. The solution shouldn't require knowledge of any tricks. It should be solvable with common intrinsic and library functions for whatever language they're using in less than 20 lines of code. And finally, the problem should be interesting to test. There should be some depth to it so that you can get an idea of how detail-oriented the programmer is and how good they are at solving problems. You want to see whether this is someone who will be able to effectively test their own code or whether they're going to be a liability in terms of introducing bugs into production without understanding what they're doing. As a candidate, you should bear all of these questions in mind. Not every interviewer asks great coding questions, but many do, and they all should. So that can really help you limit the sort of options that you look at when you're looking to solve a programming problem. That in turn can lead to better performance in the interview. As an interviewer, I can't say this enough. Before you ask a problem, make sure you've tested it out on friends, you've written solutions to it yourself, and that it's something that has at least a couple different solutions. There shouldn't be any magic trick to being able to solve it. You should be able to solve it effectively and get a higher out of solving it without having to know anything special. Thank you very much for watching the video all the way to the end. If you like the video, please give it a like, a thumbs up. And if you like this sort of content, please subscribe to the channel. I still have a lot to say about the interview process and getting better at both being an interviewer and being interviewed. I'm also going to start talking about some technical issues in the future that might be interesting to some folks. Anyways, thanks again for watching and keep on pushing forward.